Well, again, welcome everyone. You know, I was reminiscing about a trip I took with my dad to the Grand Canyon many years ago. Now, I was young and a bit immature at the time. I know some of you might argue that I'm still a bit immature now. But anyway, well, I stood at the very edge of the Grand Canyon with my back to it so my dad could take a picture of me with this canyon in the background. What a nice picture. Well, I was standing right on the edge. Now, had I slipped or the edge given away, well, it's a long way down to the bottom. At some places, the Grand Canyon is over a mile deep. I don't know how deep it was where I was standing, but I recall it was pretty much straight down. If I'd fallen, it would not have mattered whether it was a mile down or maybe a little less than a mile. The result would have been the same. Well, my dad noticed this and asked me to move closer to him so he could get a better picture. I said, "No, you move closer to me. I wanted my picture to show me right on the edge of that canyon." I might mention, by the way, there were no guardrails or anything. It was just straight down. But my dad kept insisting that I should move closer to him and the camera. Come over this way. He was trying to get me away from the edge of the canyon. And my father loves me, and he was just trying to keep me safe. If I would listen to him. Does that sound familiar? Well, I eventually relented and moved away from the edge. Then he finally took my picture. Now, later, when I was a little more mature, maybe, I realized my father was right. I was putting myself in danger by standing on the very edge of that deep canyon. But my father loves me, and he was trying to take care of me despite my rebellious attitude. I think that's a bit like our Heavenly Father. He tries to tell us what's good for us if we will listen, because he loves us too. Well, that reminds me of a story of a certain other man who did the same thing I had done. Now, he stood there at the very edge of the Grand Canyon. But he wasn't so lucky. As he stood there at the edge of the canyon, the ground gave way. He began to fall down into the canyon. Now, fortunately for him, there was a bush growing out of the side of the canyon very near the top. So this man was able to grab hold of this bush and at least temporarily stop his fall. So he's hanging onto that bush. He began to yell for help, hoping someone would come and rescue him. You know, "Help me! Help me! Somebody up there, help me!" Well, at first, there was no answer. So he continued to yell at the top of his lungs, "Help me! Somebody help me!" Suddenly, he heard a voice. The voice said, "I can hear you. Are you all right?" "Well, I'm not hurt, but I need help. I can't hold on much longer. By the way, who are you?" The voice said, "I am God. Do you have strong faith?" "Yes, yes, I believe in you. My faith is very strong."
"Good," said the voice. "Just let go of that branch and you'll be fine. I will save you."
The man paused for a second and thought quickly. Then he looked up and he said, "Is there anyone else up there that can help me?" Okay, well, I suspect this man's faith was not quite as strong as he may have thought. What do you think? Well, I know that faith, you know, when I used to go to traditional churches, faith was certainly something that they talked about, something that was a good thing, of course. You know, for example, someone might ask their pastor or church leader a question like, did God really send his son so that we might have eternal life? And to respond to that, the pastor might say something like, "Well, let's read John 3:16. Or maybe some other passages, and that would answer their question. And the words from our Bibles can certainly strengthen our faith, right? So that's a way to get faith. But sometimes, what happens if the question really doesn't have an answer in the Bible? Or worse, the question might be about a false doctrine that the church is teaching. Then what happens with the faith? We can't get it from the Bible, obviously. So how does this pastor or church leader respond to the question? Well, unable to actually prove their errant doctrine often through Scripture, they often just tell the person asking the question, "You just need to have faith." Well, faith, obviously, not in the words of the Bible, but faith in whatever this church leader says is true. Now, how do most people respond to that in a church environment with everyone around if they ask the question? You know, with people standing around, they don't want to appear to have weak faith, right? just have faith. Well, okay, well, if nothing else, their pride won't allow them to appear to have weak faith in front of others. So when their faith is challenged, they usually kind of quiet down and go along with everything. Yeah, my faith is strong. I believe whatever my pastor is telling me. Sure, I do. You know, I don't want to seem to have no faith. Yeah, I kind of think of that like the story of the emperor's new clothes, if you're familiar with that. You know, no one wants to admit that they don't see what everyone else claims they see, even if what people see, or claim to see, rather, doesn't even exist. Everyone else seems to have faith in it, looks like, so their pride won't let them appear to have weak faith in front of others. So they'll appear to go along with it, even though they may not believe it. Like the emperor's new clothes, they claim to believe something that is not even true. Again, I think they claim this. They claim to have faith in a lie because they don't want to appear different or possibly weaken the faith. You know, but by doing so, I believe they actually demonstrate a lack of true faith, if you think about it, to go along with whatever. We hear a lot about faith. So today I want to take a look at faith. Now, why is it so important? And what does the Bible have to say about it? Let's begin with some definitions. So what is faith? Well, I looked at two definitions from the Merriam-Webster Dictionary. I'm going with the second definition first, and I'll come back to the first definition in just a little bit. Now, their second definition of faith is a system of religious beliefs. A system of religious beliefs. Now, we have the Catholic faith. We have the Baptist faith. We have the Hindu faith. According to many estimates, there are roughly 4,000 faiths in the world. Now, Wikipedia and other sources say closer to 5,000. And there's a movement today that says that all faiths are equally valid. All are equally valid paths to God. I'll give you an example. This was a while back, I ran across a famous talk show host who claims to be a Christian. This host was This host was discussing spirituality and the path to God, the way to God. They were discussing this with a guest on the show. Now, the talk show host said, and quote, here's what she said, quote, "One of the mistakes that human beings make is believing there is only one way. We don't accept that. There are diverse ways of being in the world. There are millions of ways, many paths to what you call God. Her path might be something else. Her loving and her kindness and her generosity, if it brings her to the same point that it brings you, it doesn't matter whether she calls it God along the way or not. There couldn't possibly be just one way." Now, what do you think about that? Does that sound like a true statement? Let's turn over to John, if you would. John chapter 14. See if I can get my verses right this time. That's John chapter 14. We'll be looking at verses 4 through 6. That's John chapter 14, verses 4 through 6. Now, remember as we read this, that the talk show host who professes to be a Christian says, quote, "There are millions of ways, many paths, to what you call God," close quote. Okay. Now here in John 14, verse 4, Jesus was about to leave his disciples, actually, and they wanted to go with him, obviously. And Jesus told his disciples that they knew the way, but the disciples didn't know the way, or at least Thomas said they didn't know the way at the time. So again, John 14, verse 4, Jesus says, "And where you go, or where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we know not where you go, and how can we know the way?" Now in verse 6, Jesus tells Thomas, and of course us, how we're to come to God, the true God, our Heavenly Father. Let's see what he says. Verse 6, Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." There couldn't possibly be just one way. If we believe our Bibles, if we believe the words of Jesus Christ we just read, then there is exactly one way. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Let's take another look at this. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 4. Easy to remember. Ephesians 4, verse 4. So, again, the question, how many valid faiths are there really? How many actual paths are there to the true God? Are there 4,000? 5,000? Millions? According to the talk show host, there are millions. But according to the Bible, Ephesians 4, verse 4, there is one body and one spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, look at this next, what comes next? One faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So, if we are true believers of Jesus Christ and believe our Bibles, then there is one and only one true way. There is one and only one valid faith. Everyone does not understand that today, but we know that all in the future will come to know. Ezekiel 37 verses 12 through 14 is one place we can see this. There are other places as well. What about that other definition from the Merriam-Webster dictionary I talked about earlier? Actually, this is the first definition. We read the second earlier. Here's their first definition, and it says that faith is, quote, a strong belief or trust in someone or something. A strong belief or trust in someone or something. How many of us, for example, might have faith that our car will actually start when we get in and attempt to start it? Well, most of the time it does, right? How many of us have faith that our computers will always boot up and run properly when we turn them on? Now, on second thought, we might forget about the computers. Our computers here certainly didn't boot up and work as expected a few weeks ago. Back to our vehicles. If we, for example, drive newer, well-maintained vehicles, we might trust or believe in them to a degree. Now, we generally have faith that they'll start every time and take us wherever we want to go. And most of the time, they do. But even if they're kept in great shape, they can still occasionally let us down. We can't always have complete faith in our machines. They can occasionally fail, as I've been noticing lately. You might remember the space shuttles. Remember the NASA and the space shuttle program? Well, they prepared those space shuttles meticulously for their missions, particularly with the Challenger and the Columbia. But they failed anyway. You recall, even though they tried really hard, they had some serious failures in those two spacecraft. We really can't have complete faith in any of man's creations. And really, no matter how much faith we might have in a person, they're still capable of making mistakes. We can only have complete faith in the one true God and His Word. Now, as I'm speaking today, should you trust everything I say? Should you have faith in me and believe I'll always be right without question? No, right. They're responding with that. I hear the no's. Okay. Well, you're absolutely correct. We should always check to see if what's being said matches our Bibles. And if it does, hang on to it, right? If it doesn't, we need to reject it, no matter who said it. Well, I'm sure we're all familiar with 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 21. You can turn there if you like. That's 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 21. You can probably read it down here on our logo. But this is certainly one of my favorite passages in the entire Bible, and I believe one of the very most important. In fact, like I say, it's part of our logo. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 21 tells us, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. Now, you might say, well, what happens if we don't always check what's being said? Can we trust people? We trust our leaders? What happens if we fail to verify what's being said with the Word of God? And just believe whatever imperfect humans might tell us. Well, if we do that, we might just end up teaching our children to worship a rather large man in a red suit instead of our true Savior that is the real bringer of gifts and of our answered prayers, Jesus Christ, of course. Who knows? In the spring, rather than teaching our children about the Lamb of God and His great love and sacrifice for us, we're liable to teach them about bunnies that lay eggs. And it doesn't stop there. We'll end up with thousands of different faiths based on man's wisdom, assisted by Satan, instead of God's holy word. You know, if we would all of us, prove everything with the word of God, then I believe the world might just indeed have one faith. I think it would happen. And we might not agree on every little detail where Scripture is not crystal clear, but I believe we would at least be on the same page, and we would not have literally thousands of faiths or denominations with maybe millions of different paths to God. Let's turn over, if you would, to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, and I think this is often called the faith chapter. That's Hebrews chapter 11, and we'll begin in verse 1. Hebrews chapter 11. So we looked at a dictionary for the definition of faith. But let's look at the biblical definition of faith, and I believe we'll find it here in Hebrews 11, verse 1. And it says right off the bat, "Now faith is," now here's the biblical definition of faith. "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." The word faith in verse 1 is the Greek word 4102 in Strong's. It's pistis, and it means belief, faith, or fidelity. The word substance, according to Strong's, is assurance. And evidence is proof or conviction. So we might read Hebrews 11, verse 1 as follows. We could probably read it like this. "Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the proof of things not seen." The proof of things not seen. Did anyone of us actually see the earth being created? Anyone see that? You'd be older than I am if that's the case. That's old, yeah. Thank you a lot. That's old, yeah. But how do we know who made it, really? How do we know? What proof do we have? Well, if you would, let's hold your place here in Hebrews chapter 11, if you would. We'll be coming right back to it. But turn over briefly, if you would, to John chapter 1. For an example, that's John chapter 1, and we'll begin right there in verse 1. And here we'll read in our Bibles who it was that made the earth and everything else for that matter. Again, that's John chapter 1 and verse 1. And we're told here, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God." Verse 3, "All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made." So who was this Word? Drop down to verse 14. I think we'll recognize who this is in verse 14. That's John 1, verse 14. I'm in the King James. "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Well, I think it's obvious here that the Word is the only begotten Son of the Father, Jesus Christ. So there we have it. Our Bibles can prove these things to us. Back to Hebrews 11, now verse 3, the next verse, Hebrews 11 and verse 3. "Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear." Or as the English Standard Version puts it, "By faith we understand that the universe was created by the Word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible." I believe that most of us have proven that our Bibles were written by the inspiration of God and are profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. But sadly, many Christians today don't really study and believe what their Bibles say. Many today just believe whatever their pastor or other church leader tells them. Now, if they do that, what assurance do they have that everything their pastor tells them is absolutely true? How do they know it's true? Well, they really have no assurance. Without proving it to themselves from their own Bibles, their faith is not really assured. You know, I suspect that many today actually might have doubts about immediately going to heaven and playing cards when they die. After all, they've never seen this anywhere in Scripture. Why not? Because it isn't there. And this, I would think would have to make them a bit uneasy, to say the least. You know, hoping their pastor is right, but in the back of their minds, wondering what really does happen to us, since they never really proved this from their own Bibles. Is their pastor really correct? And what about all those other church leaders out there that disagree with their pastor? I mean, how can they be sure that their pastor is right and the others are wrong? But we, brethren, do have the assurance of our great future. We have the promise and the assurance of the resurrections, for example. You know, Jesus was our example. When he died for us, how is it that he came to live again? Anyone know? I hope so. By the way of the resurrection. And just as Jesus Christ was resurrected from the dead, as our example, so shall we all be. And the Bible has much to say about the resurrections. But we have faith in a future that we can earnestly look forward to be a part of, for some of us, even to reign with Christ in the millennium. We know our future is assured if we have faith in God. He tells us so. And we believe God because we have faith in him. But our faith depends on us needing to know and understand God and his word. No man can just command us to have faith. We must each become convinced in our own minds. As we grow in our knowledge of God, we'll become confident and assured of the accuracy of the past that the Bible details, and also assured of his promises for the future, like the coming of the kingdom of God. Verse 6, if you haven't lost your place there, Hebrews 11, verse 6. Just how important is it for us to have faith? Again, verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and, notice the and, that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I did check out the word impossible to make sure it was really impossible, and it is. You can check it out. But he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, we often hear, just believe. But according to Hebrews 11, verse 6, it's not just to believe in him, but to seek him, to learn and grow in his ways. And we cannot just believe in something or someone we know nothing about. You know, think about it. Would we believe in or completely trust a stranger we might just happen to run into in a parking lot? Well, unfortunately, we can't always trust everyone we meet these days. That's very sad. Before we really trust a stranger, we need to take time to get to know them. Then some amount of trust will likely develop, especially if they deserve our trust. But according to Hebrews 11, verse 6, it's not just to believe in God or that he exists, but to seek him, to come to know him, to learn and grow in his ways. If you would hold your place here in Hebrews chapter 11, if you can, we'll be coming back to it in a little bit. It'll be a little bit, but we'll come back to it. For now, let's look at Mark chapter 9, verse 23. That's Mark chapter 9 and verse 23. And to really confuse you, while we're turning over to Mark chapter 9, verse 23, I'd like to just quickly read James 2, verse 19 to you. You probably remember this. It tells us that, well, it says, you believe that there is one God. You do well. The devils also believe and tremble. Well, simple belief that God exists is not enough. Satan and his demons believe that God exists, but I don't think any of us really want their future. There's a difference here. We need to not only believe that God exists, we need to believe in him. That his ways are the right ways. That his commandments indeed teach us the right way to live and also to become a part of his coming great kingdom. And as we come to believe in the Father and in Jesus Christ, as we come to truly know them, only then can we truly have strong faith. Faith in God is not something we can just will to happen. No one can simply command us to have faith in God. They try that, but it doesn't work. We need to come to know the Father and Jesus Christ by studying his word and learning who they really are. Only then can we truly come to really love them, and only then can we really have faith in them. Now here in Mark, here in Mark chapter 9, it's where a man had a son who was possessed by a demon. And if you recall, even Jesus' disciples were not able to rid this young man of the demon. But notice what Jesus said to this man's father when he showed up. Again, that's Mark 9, verse 23. Jesus said to him, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes." The word believe here is the Greek word 4100 in Strong's. It's pisuo, and it means to have faith. So Jesus told the Father, if you can have faith, all things are possible to him that has faith. Now, I know our faith isn't perfected at this point, but let's look closely at what really strong faith is capable of. Let's take a look over at Matthew 21, verse 19, if you would. That's where we went to, right? Just took us a while to get there. Okay, Matthew 21, verse 19. "And when he," Jesus, "saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon, but leaves only, and said to it, 'Let no fruit grow on you henceforth forever.' And presently the fig tree withered away. And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, 'How soon is this fig tree withered away?' Jesus answered and said to them, 'Verily I say to you, if you have faith and doubt not, you shall not only do this, which is done to the fig tree, but also if you shall say unto this mountain, "Be removed, and be you cast into the sea," it shall be done. And all things whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive." I think it's often the doubt not that can really be difficult for us sometimes. Because try as we might, we often have doubt creep in. And we're still human, and we're not fully perfected yet. So here's a question. Did Jesus' disciples have faith in him when he was with them? Do they have faith in him then? What do you think? Well, I'd say, sure. I'm sure they did. Well, to an extent anyway. So how strong was their faith? And did they doubt? Did they have problems with doubt? Let's go to Matthew 14, back a few chapters. Matthew chapter 14. And we'll read verses 25 and 26, I believe it is. Matthew chapter 14, beginning in verse 25. Let's see how strong Peter's faith was. He was one of the disciples. So we'll pick up the story there. Now, after feeding the 5,000, Jesus told the disciples, including Peter, of course, to go ahead of him and take a ship to the other side of the sea. Meanwhile, Jesus sent the multitude away and went to the mountain to pray. He would catch up with the disciples later on. Well, the wind was blowing against the direction the ship was traveling. The disciples weren't making much progress crossing the sea, and the wind was kicking up some mighty big waves. The Bible tells us that the ship was being tossed about by these waves. The time is the fourth watch of the night. Now, that would be sometime in the last 3 hours of the night, right before sunrise. So it was very late at night on top of everything else. And no doubt the disciples were a bit concerned about these big waves and their lack of progress crossing the sea. I'd say they were probably afraid. Let's see what happened beginning in Matthew 14, verse 25. "And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, 'It is a spirit,' and they cried out for fear." You know, I think I can imagine they were really scared about this point. You know, it's late at night, very late at night. The waves are all around, the wind's blowing. And now they see this apparition. Verse 27. "But straightway Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Be of good cheer, it is I. Be not afraid.' And Peter answered him and said, 'Lord, if it be you, bid me come to you on the water.' And he," Jesus, "said, 'Come.' And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus." Let's pause here just a moment. When I read this, I guess for the first time, you know, if you think about it, would Would we say at this point that Peter displayed great faith in Jesus? Great faith. I mean, to get out of a ship late at night, you're probably tired, into the water, to try to walk to Jesus on this rough sea with the wind blowing? Well, I'd say, personally, I'd say that Peter exhibited great faith, don't you think? I would say that. That's what I would say. If his faith allowed him to walk on water, what else might his faith allow him to do, as Jesus said? Think about that. With great faith, we can do great things, right? Well, let's see how this turns out. How did this great faith of Peter work? Verse 30. But when he, Peter, saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. So what just happened here? Peter doubted. His faith wasn't exactly perfect. Now, it looks as though he had great faith, based on what we might consider to be great faith, despite his eventual doubt. I mean, think of it. How many of us would have tried that? Think about it. It's in the wee hours of the morning, it's still dark. You got the waves all around you, the boat's rocking back and forth, the wind's blowing, and you jump out of the boat to walk over to Jesus. I mean, that's, how many of us would do that? Be honest. Okay. I don't know how many of us would do that. But anyway, considering that, it would seem to me personally that Peter had great faith based on what I might consider to be great faith, even despite his eventual doubt. But that's my opinion, right? What did Jesus think of Peter's faith? Did he think he had great faith like I did? Verse 31. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him. So Jesus saved him and said to him, O you of little faith, why did you doubt? By the standards of Christ, Peter had little faith. So if that's the case, where does that leave all of us today? Is our faith as strong as the faith Peter had that night when he jumped into that raging sea? Well, even then, Jesus said Peter had little faith. But of course, to give Peter credit, remember that was before Peter and the rest of the disciples received the Holy Spirit, something we have today. So you may have a little bit of an excuse there. Let's turn back to Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8 and verse 5. That's Matthew chapter 8 and verse 5. I'd like to look at a few more biblical examples of faith. Let's see the results of having great faith in the Father and Jesus Christ. What happens when we have great faith? Again, that's Matthew chapter 8, verse 5. And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion beseeching him and saying, Lord, my servant lies at home sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered, and under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. So he had belief. He trusted Jesus. Verse 9, for he tells us why. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this man, go, and he goes. And to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. Well, this centurion understood authority. Whatever he ordered by his authority, he knew it would be done. He also recognized Jesus and his authority. He had great faith in Jesus Christ, and he knew that if Jesus gave the word, there would be absolutely no doubt that his servant would be healed. Verse 10. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to them that followed, Verily I say to you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. Put it into verse 13, if you would. Verse 13. And Jesus said to the centurion, Go your way, and as you have believed, so be it done to you. The centurion believed he had faith. And continuing, and his servant was healed in the same hour. So this centurion had strong faith in Christ. He showed little doubt. Turn over to Mark 5, verse 25, if you would. We'll look at another person who exhibited what I believe is great faith. That's Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5 and verse 25. You may be familiar with this story, but here we find a woman that had had a problem with bleeding for 12 years. and no one, absolutely no one up to this point, could help her. Again, that's Mark 5, verse 25. And a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. So she spent all her money, and she wasn't getting better. In fact, she was getting even worse. So just imagine that. This is bleeding for 12 years. I'm sure she'd be physically weak from all that blood loss. She spent everything she had on doctors. Didn't do her any good, but now she was broke. She couldn't be a mother. She couldn't have any intimacy. And she was unclean, as defined in Leviticus. So people would shun her because if they touched her, then they would become unclean. I believe she would have lived on the outskirts of town, away from those who were not diseased. That was common. And she was most likely, in addition to everything else, a very lonely woman. Did this woman have great faith in Christ? Let's see verse 27. When she'd heard of Jesus, came in the press or the crowd behind and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch his clothes, I shall be healed. Yet a person that was unclean as she was just doesn't go around touching people. And many believe that intentionally touching people when you're unclean would possibly result in some punishment, maybe even stoning, even her death. So I believe she was taking a big chance that Jesus was the Messiah. You know, our man hanging on that bush earlier, well, he wasn't willing to take that chance. His faith wasn't strong enough. And this woman might have been facing something potentially just as bad, possibly stoning. So was her faith strong? Or did she look somewhere else? Verse 29. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague or disease. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press or the crowd and said, who touched my clothes? And his disciples said to him, you see the multitude thronging you or crowding about you, and you say, who touched me? He looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you whole. Go in peace and be whole of your plague, or be healed of your disease. So I don't think this is just a matter of going to see if Christ could help her. And if he couldn't, oh well. You know, most likely if someone had recognized her and her uncleanliness, she might have been stopped, and as I said, possibly stoned to death before she even made it to Jesus. And she did make it to Jesus, and he was not who she believed he was, I think she'd probably been in serious, serious trouble then. At any rate, I'd say she had little doubt as to who Christ was, and she demonstrated very great faith, as Christ said. Let's go back to Hebrews 11, verse 7. Hope you had kept your place there. Hebrews 11, verse 7. So we've seen a few people that were rewarded for their faith. I'd like to look at some other examples of faith in the Bible here in Hebrews 11. So let's take a look at this back in Hebrews 11, verse 7. Let's continue there. Talking about faith. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with his fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out not knowing where he went. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which had foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Verse 11. Through faith, also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Here we see Sarah had faith. Verse 12. Therefore sprang there even of one, as and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sand which is by the seashore innumerable. Now these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Now we could continue reading about faith for some time. Our Bibles were full of examples of men and women who exhibited great faith, and they were often greatly rewarded. Let's skip down to verse 32 to try to sum this up. That's verse 32. Hebrews 11, verse 32. And what shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and of Barak and of Samson, of Jephthah and of David also, and of Samuel and of the prophets, who through faith, this is how important faith is, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Now, I'm sure we can recall many of these stories of great faith in our Bibles, and they stand as absolutely amazing examples of what strong faith can do. I think we can all see that having great faith can do many things. So I think that's something we all need. Of course, we need to work on that. But I came up with 7 ways to increase our faith. There are probably many others, but here's some ones I came up with we might want to think about. Some may be obvious. Well, the first one will probably surprise you. It's studying the Bible, right? Studying the Bible. Let's turn to 2 Timothy, if you have time, 2 verse 15. That's 2 Timothy 2, chapter 2 and verse 15. I know some of us read our Bibles, but we need to sometimes study it. Not just read through it, but actually study the words carefully. So again, 2 Timothy 2, verse 15 tells us, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So again, we don't want to take everyone's word for it, anyone's word for it. We want to study and rightly divide the word of truth. Now, for you new people out there, keep on studying. The Bible might seem difficult to understand in the beginning, especially if you're trying to unlearn years of false teaching. That can make things difficult. But you'll find things will get better in a hurry, so hang in there and keep studying. As our understanding increases, we come to more and more see the beauty of God's creation and His great plan of salvation. Our love and faith in Him will continue to grow stronger. So studying, not just reading our Bibles, is great for strengthening our faith. Let's look next at Romans 10. If you would, Romans chapter 10 and verse 13. That's Romans chapter 10 and verse 13. Now, it's not that we shouldn't listen to people, because I believe listening to sermons can actually help us. Let's read about that in Romans 10, verse 13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, most people stop there, but let's keep reading. Verse 14. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? Again, that word believe there is G4100 in Strong's, meaning to have faith. So, and how shall they believe or have faith in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? This is hearing from a preacher. Drop down to verse 17, if you would. Verse 17. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So I believe listening to sermons will help increase our faith. We can often learn more quickly listening to others who study their Bibles ahead of time. They've got the scriptures put together for us, so there's certainly some value in that. But as always, we need to always be sure we examine our own Bibles and confirm that everything that's said is true by using the Word of God. Anything else? How about prayer? Well, prayer will certainly help. If we really want to become familiar with someone, what do we do? If we had someone we want to get closer to or learn about them, we'll probably have conversations with them, right? Talk to them. You know, we can let others describe someone to us. That might be okay, but if we really want to get to know the real person, The best way is to talk to them personally, not third party, to have conversations with them one-on-one. So I would suggest we would talk to God. In fact, we should probably pray without ceasing, as we're told. So prayer, James 1 verse 5, if you would. James 1 verse 5, James chapter 1 verse 5. And specifically, if we're praying, we might want to pray for more wisdom. Wisdom, which in turn would help increase our faith. Again, that's James 1 verse 5. It tells us, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that gives to all men liberally and upbraids not, and it shall be given to him. Verse 6, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, or not having doubt, kind of like Peter, I guess, or like that centurion we just read about, you know, faith, not wavering. For he that wavers is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So another reason we want to learn the truth and study for ourselves to get it right, rather than to go from one doctrine to the other. We have to prove everything before we jump, you might say. We can pray for wisdom, but remember, we need faith even when we pray. My fourth item is seeing God. You might find that odd because John 1 verse 18 tells us that no man has seen God at any time. And I'm not disagreeing with that. But some people go too far with it, I think. And I've heard people say, well, yeah, I've never seen God. And the Bible's, well, it's just a collection of fictitious stories created by man to try to teach us how to live. That's all it is. Well, you know, the Bible was written many years ago. And a large part of the Bible is prophecy. If we study the Bible, then look at history, we'll see that much prophecy has been fulfilled in the past just as it was foretold. If we keep up with current events, I think we can see prophecy being fulfilled in the present. Fulfilled prophecy should give us faith that our Bibles indeed contain the inspired Word of God. Now, maybe we don't see God the Father in the physical sense. Okay, I get that. But I believe we can see God. I believe we can at least see the hand of God in his inspired words, in the world around us. And the same is true of answered prayers. They're not a coincidence. So I think we can actually look to see the hand of God at work. We can watch to see Bible prophecy being fulfilled. We might keep a list of our answered prayers and other blessings we've been given, I know many of which sometimes seem to come out of nowhere and defy explanation. I've seen that many times. I believe this will strengthen our faith. So I think we can actually see God, maybe not visibly, but we can see him in the earth, the creation, his answered prayers, and the wonderful things and blessings we get. Going on here to get toward the end here, number five is fellowship. Iron sharpens iron. I'll remind you again of Proverbs 27, verse 17, that tells us, iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. Now, when we fellowship with other believers, what happens? Well, for one thing, we often hear their stories, how they came into the truth, when they recall, how they react. And those, I love hearing that. That's a good thing at the Feast of Tabernacles. We get to hear the stories of these people. You know, how'd you come into this? And that's very uplifting and assuring to us. And we also hear about their answered prayers. And they share their walk with us, their studies with us, their knowledge with us. And together, we all help strengthen each other's faith because we're all sharing our faith. That helps a lot. My sixth item is fasting. Fasting. Now, we know Christ fasted, right? About Daniel. Esther and the Jews, that was 3 days, I believe. We know in Matthew 6, verse 16, Jesus says, you know, if you decide to fast, no, I'm kidding. Matthew 6, verse 16 says, moreover, when you fast. So it's not if, it's when. Jesus expects us to fast. I mean, should we wait until a crisis comes along before we fast all the time? No, I think prayer and fasting can help us now to increase our faith, among many other things. Fasting can do a lot for us, but I think most of us kind of look over that. But think about that. And the seventh item, and I'll wind it up here pretty quick, something I've not mentioned yet that you're probably wondering about, and that is God's Holy Spirit. Now, if a person has not been called by God and does not yet have his Holy Spirit, I believe it's difficult to really have great faith. Now, this is something we can always pray about. And we can always ask God for his Holy Spirit or for more of his Holy Spirit. Now, for those of us who already possess God's Holy Spirit, we've been given the opportunity to have true hope, true confidence, and true comfort, the kind that can only be obtained through true faith in God. You know, while others play the emperor's new clothes with ideas like playing cards or engaging in their favorite pastime in heaven when we die, these are ideas, of course, with no proof or assurance of any kind, which can create doubt. You know, we, brethren, we have the assurance of our future in the kingdom by our true faith in God. So in conclusion, there are not 5,000 valid faiths. There are not 1,000,000 paths of what people call God, just one. And without faith, we cannot please God. Today we saw some great displays of faith by many in the Bible. And we saw that faith can give us things like strength and boldness and confidence, even the ability to walk on water. That's amazing. The faith gives us assurances for our future, assurances that sadly few have today. We looked at just 7 ways to strengthen our faith, and I'm sure there are more. But I want to end with just one final question for all of us today. Here's my question. Think about this, if you would. Are we satisfied with the level of faith that we currently have? Think about that for a second or two. Is our level of faith where we want it to be? Or do you think it's where God would like it to be? You know, as great as Peter's faith was when he got out of that ship and into those turbulent waters, by Jesus' standards, Peter had little faith. So let's never become complacent, and let's never stop growing closer to Jesus Christ. Let's not allow our faith to ever become stagnant. Let's continue to work on ways to strengthen our faith, to gain even greater assurance and confidence in our future and also the future of others, our loved ones. So let's turn to Ephesians 3, verse 13. That's Ephesians chapter 3, verse 13. It'll be our last scripture today. We'll end with that. Again, that's Ephesians 3, verse 13. You know, I think we all see that the world is declining at an ever-accelerating pace. And there's no telling what we might experience in the near future, what trials or tribulations we might have to face. So, not that it wasn't before, but now is certainly the time for us to have strong faith. Like Daniel, like Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, our faith needs to be strong too. And not just for ourselves, but also for those depending on us, both now and in the kingdom of God. So again, Ephesians 3, verse 13, to close today's service, we'll read till the end of the chapter through verse 21 and end. My prayer today, I would say, for all of us, is the same as we see with Paul here. So my prayer is the same as Paul's. See what he says. Ephesians 3:13. Wherefore I desire that you faint not at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, unto him be glory in the church by Jesus Christ throughout all ages, world without end. Amen.